Ladies, thank you so much for getting involved in this Pretty in Pink Breast Cancer Awareness Session with Sharon from the White Rock Children's Centre. We've got Annie Traynor, who is a breast nurse in Craigavon Area Hospital, and our lovely friend and volunteer and previous patient, Maria Kelly. So I'm just going to give a brief synopsis about the charity and what we do and how we help people. And then Maria is going to come in and give us, she's going to discuss her diagnosis and explain to us how the charity helped her. And then we'll go to Annie and then to Sharon. So for those who are not aware, Pretty in Pink was founded back in 2006 by my sister Nolene. Nolene was diagnosed with breast cancer when she was 22, so she was a very, very young woman at the time of her diagnosis. She knew only too well about what a breast cancer patient needed during that time of diagnosis, surgery, treatment, and ultimate recovery, and that's why she did found the charity Pretty in Pink. Pretty in Pink operate a support fund, which means that people can apply to us for help, financial help, whilst they're going through their breast cancer journey. That support financially could be for home heating oil, electricity, food, mastectomy, underwear, wigs, anything really that the patient feels that they need at that specific time. We do also want to get families involved in this, because ultimately at the end of the day they're going through this as well. So we would offer respite breaks for families. People can take their mums or dads or friends or whoever's been there with them on their journey out for dinner. We can help fund things like that. In the last year, Pretty in Pink launched the Information and Support Hub. And the point of that was we felt that during the surgery and treatment and things like that, there is help there and everyone's around you and everyone's helping you to get through this. But when that finishes, the help just ends and there's no real support there. So that's what Pretty in Pink wanted to do. He set out to provide more services to help those people, I suppose, take the next step of their journey. So with that, we launched our counselling services and our complementary therapy services. They're all done here at the Hub in the Park Centre. However, with COVID, no treatments or anything like that has been able to take place throughout the last year. So we are really looking forward to being able to get that up and running again and get the people back in, because the help is very much needed by those patients and their families. So that's a wee bit about Pretty in Pink and what we do and what we set out to do. So I'm going to go now to Maria, who is going to tell us about her and her story.
Okay. Hi everybody. I really don't have anything prepared, but I'm just going to talk, and if you want to ask me any other questions if I haven't covered anything, please let me know. But as Leanne said, Pretty in Pink was founded by Nolene, and Nolene was a friend of mine at school, so we were really pretty close. And Pretty in Pink has always been something that I've been involved with, you know, indirectly at, you know, in the early stages. I never ever thought that I would need be calling on the services of Pretty in Pink. But in October 2018, I found, I can only describe it as a hardness. It wasn't a lump as such. So whenever you see all these bits and pieces of info about breast cancer diagnosis, everybody talks about a lump, but generally it's just something that is not something that you were aware of before, something that's different, something that you need to report. So I had a hardness, and I also had a pain in my arm. So really, to be honest with you, the pain in my arm is what really made me go and see about it. I suppose with Nolene being so close, I knew to keep an eye out for changes that I needed to report. And I could honestly say that if I didn't know Nolene or Pretty in Pink, I don't think I would have been diagnosed as quickly as it was. So I knew just to go straight away and get sorted out. So I made my appointment, and the 2-week referral was made in the city. And then on that day in the city, I found out that I was diagnosed with cancer straight away. It was absolutely, as you can imagine, just an absolute whirlwind, and you're given all these bits of information. I actually came out with a folder that day. It's just so much to take in. But in among all that, there was a wee Pretty in Pink flower. And to be honest with you, it's a wee bit emotional even talking about it, because when I saw that, I knew I would be okay. And I knew that there was help there with the girls. And there's just not enough said about Pretty in Pink, to be fair. So in terms of the help that they've provided for me, everybody has a different reaction, a different way that they take it on. But Leanne probably knows me inside out. And some days I'd be just thinking, God, I'm feeling really down. And Leanne will send me a wee text message and I'm thinking, right, okay. How did she know that I needed to speak to somebody today? But on a more practical level, Pretty in Pink supported me in terms of Leanne referred me to reflexology and Reiki and things that were good for settling. My mind goes into overdrive and I need to know about everything that's going to happen to me. I'm one of these people that reads everything. So obviously there's things that you're not really meant to read. So it was just to take me out of that loop and kind of settle me. And it just helped so much throughout my treatment. It was just invaluable. It just gave me perspective in, you know, getting to the end of this and seeing that everything is going to be okay. And as I say, I mean, if I hadn't have known about the wee cards and stuff that Leanne does, you know, the check yourself in the shower and things to look out for, I probably would have been sitting for a wee while longer before actually telling somebody that was an issue for me. So aside from that as well, Leanne would be very good with like putting you in contact with other people, because you do feel very alone whenever you've got your diagnosis. So I've been in contact with other patients, and it's good to bounce off somebody who actually knows what you're going through. And then in turn, I've hopefully been able to help other people as well who've been, you know, given a new diagnosis, and I've been there and done that, and hopefully I can help them out in some way or another. But as I say, I would just be lost without Pretty in Pink.
Maria, thank you so much for all those lovely words. As you say, because you knew Nolene, and whenever it came around to what you found, you were aware because of Nolene and because of the charity. But I suppose so many other people don't know that and don't know kind of what to look for. I suppose it's some people associate breast cancer with it's something that happens in older women. And me and Nolene were very much like that at the time of her own diagnosis. When we went to the hospital, she was 22 and I was 19, and there was older women around us at that time. And I suppose we were a bit naive, as in, like, what's actually going on here? You know, why are we here? And it's all older people. And unfortunately, you know, Nolene had been diagnosed then. So in a way, it kind of, it opened our eyes as to, oh my goodness, this can actually happen to young women. And Nolene was very, very young, I know that. But it does make you more aware, because there's somebody who is close to you, you know, that's gone through that. But so many other people aren't aware of that. And a lot of people also aren't aware that men can get breast cancer also, which I feel is a really important thing to raise. So many men are unaware that they can get a diagnosis of breast cancer. So we try our best here within the charity to raise awareness of what set out at the beginning was raise awareness amongst young women. We try to raise awareness to everyone, absolutely everyone, that it doesn't matter what age you are, you can get diagnosed, and it doesn't matter whether you're male or female, you can still get that that diagnosis. One important thing is, you know, what do we look for? Maria, you touched on that there when you said, you know, people are, it's all, you know, put out there that you look for a lump or a bump or things like that. And that's something that you didn't have, which I feel is a really important issue. So we're going to go and now speak to Annie Trainer. Annie is a breast care nurse in Craigavon Area Hospital, and she's going to talk us and give us a little bit of information about how to check yourself, what to look out for, and what's the right thing to do. Okay, Annie.
Hi, everybody. Can you hear me? Mm-hmm. Thanks very much for inviting me along, first of all, to come to this very important event. And it was lovely to listen to Maria and her story. I really feel for her, and she's a great girl and she's doing so well. So I've been a breast care nurse for 21 years. So at this stage of the game, I should be well used to advising women and men about what to look out for. And it's interesting the way Maria said that she didn't actually feel a lump. So what I tend to say to ladies is that they should examine their breasts on a monthly basis, once a month, either the beginning of the month or the end of the month, for example. And they should feel each breast. And apart from looking out for lumps or bumps, the word I would use is a thickening. This is just an area of the breast tissue that feels slightly thicker than any other part of the breast. So if any woman or man notices any thickening, or if they notice, for example, some bleeding from the nipple, or if they notice lumps or bumps underneath their armpit or up in this area here, that is something that they should report to their own GP as soon as possible. And they needn't feel that they're wasting anybody's time by taking up a slot at a breast clinic, because it is very important that women of all ages and men are seen in a timely fashion. And if there is a diagnosis of breast cancer, then the sooner it's diagnosed, the better. Or if it's not a breast cancer, well, then they get the reassurance that it's something completely benign and nothing to worry about. The other things to look out for in the breast would be any signs of redness or a rash around the nipple that wasn't there before. Again, anything at all unusual in either breast should be reported to their own GP, and then they will be referred to their local breast clinic. Any swelling underneath either armpit as well should be reported to the GP, or any wee lumps or bumps up around this area here. The little hollow bit near your collarbone area is also linked to the lymph glands, so it's important for any changes there to be reported. I'm not sure if there's anything else I was going to say. They do say in all the magazines and books that pain is not a sign of a breast cancer, but at the same time, breast pain is something that can be very distressing for ladies. And if they have any breast pain that is constant and doesn't go away, it's important to flag that up with their GP and be seen at a breast clinic, hopefully for a mammogram, maybe an ultrasound, and get reassurance. All right. Is that okay? Thank you.
Thank you. Yeah, that's very valuable information there. Just touching again on what Maria said and the what you use, the thickening of the breast. In the shower cards, for example, the Pretty in Pink provide, do you feel that they give enough information to people, or is that something, is there others? Lots of other symptoms that people aren't aware of that aren't being advertised, and that's why people aren't picking things up.
Yes, I'm having a look at the shower card now as I speak, and it is very useful and really good. But it probably could do with another couple of symptoms put on it. I don't know if you can make it slightly longer, in the future, and add on. It does say lumps, but maybe it was thickening could be added on, and discharge from the nipple. That's two things that can be a sign of a problem in a woman's breast.
Yeah, that's really interesting and good to know, because there are other symptoms out there that people aren't really and don't associate with breast cancer, but they could be invaluable to someone. Early detection saves lives, and that's the message that we want to get across, and as you say, encourage people to do it, make this part of your monthly routine. The more you check, then the quicker you will pick up any changes to your breast. So that is that's really important for everyone to note there. We're going to move on to Sharon. Sharon was one of our service users, and again has her own experience with breast cancer. So away you go, Sharon.
Okay, Leanne, thank you. I mean, like Maria, I also was diagnosed in 2018, June 2018, and I remember again, like yourself, Maria, it was more of a thickness than it was a lump. And I remember going to the GP, and it was just before my 40th birthday. So happy birthday me and all of that that came with that. And I remember going to the GP and him thinking, no, that's nothing. Doesn't feel like anything. What do you want me to do is what he said. And I says, I want you to make a referral. And I remember thinking back after my treatment and everything else going, if I hadn't been persistent with that GP that day, I potentially wouldn't have got that diagnosis as quick as I should have. So, I mean, I suppose if one thing that people take away from maybe if they're listening to us, that if you have some of those signs and symptoms that Annie or Maria or Leanne have talked about, that don't take no for an answer is what I would say. And be persistent. And I suppose like Maria, I didn't realize as well, the day that I went to get my scan or my mammogram, and I was told I had cancer, I didn't bring anybody with me because I didn't think that I was going to get the results that day. So I remember standing outside the city hospital and phoning my husband, and he was all like, well, everything okay? And I says, no, not really. And he says, why not? And I says, because I have cancer. And he went, what? And he says, hold on. He says, I'm coming now. So, and then he drove over and got me because I was just, my head was just all over the place, and I was forgetting a taxi home and everything. And I remember just being, my whole thing was just, I was just in a bit of a whirlwind. And I just kept thinking, I have two kids at home. They're young, they're under the age of 10. And here was me, 39, because my birthday wasn't in August, and being just diagnosed with breast cancer. So that was, it was daunting, and it is difficult. And but one of the things I would say is having the likes of some of the breast nurses that were brilliant. In terms of being able to have a conversation with, and just to be able to, I like you, Maria, I also like to know everything. In fairness, my oncologist, I was her worst nightmare because I used to go in with a list of questions to ask. Yeah. And she just wanted to hide from me. She'd go in, here she comes again, and she's looking stats, and she's looking this, and she's looking that. But that was just the way I dealt with it. And as you say, Leanne, I was a service user initially when I got diagnosed. I just wanted to do something for the kids. I wanted to take them away somewhere because we were very honest with our kids from the very beginning. Because I was just afraid that they knew, would know everything that was going on and wouldn't know what to do. So I always wanted them to be able to ask me the questions. And we took them away, and we were only able to do that because Pretty in Pink were able to help us out after I had got my operation and everything initially. And I remember taking them away and going, isn't this a brilliant service that... this is something that it takes away some of the financial things, you know, maybe at that stage I was worried about money financially because I was going to be on out sick, and you were just worrying about where your next mortgage payment was coming from and all of that. So it was good to be able to get someone to pay for us to take the kids away for the weekend to have a conversation. And we went through, we actually had got a book. I remember getting this book that had been given to us by the breast nurse. And it was Mummy Has a Lump or something it's called, if I remember the title. And I remember reading through it with them and talking to them and being able to give them the chance to ask any questions. And I remember it was good to know that those services were there, that they were available for us at the time and that we could go to for support, because I then at a later date got some holistic therapies from yourselves as well. And from it, I've been a real advocate of all of that, you know, in terms of dealing with stress and even getting the children into using things as well to help them. So it's something that I feel very strongly about. So when Kevin was looking for different things for the Fela, I was thinking it was just something that jumped out at me, because I know with COVID at the minute, a lot of people are maybe sitting in the house, aren't phoning the doctor in the same way as they would have phoned, maybe think that they're annoying the doctor. But believe you me, my message would be, don't feel that you're annoying them. Do annoy them. See if you can't get an appointment. Keep at them saying, I need an appointment. I need somebody to see. You know your own body. What you were saying about the thickness and all, see, looking back on it, one of my signs that I didn't think of at the same time and I should have was tiredness. I was exhausted for months, exhausted. And looking back on it, that was probably a sign that my body was trying to fight this in some way. And if I had, I just kept taking vitamins and thinking, oh, maybe I'm just run down or whatever. But in hindsight, it was probably a big indicator that I was, there was something not right. And then I found the lump after that. So I suppose, as you say, there's probably other signs and symptoms. Everybody knows their own body. And if you're just not feeling right, you're better off getting checked out if you can. As I say, my diagnosis was June 2018, went through chemo right up until the December. And it had its good points and it had its bad points. I mean, one of the things I would say is that due to my going through what I've gone through, I'm not the same person. And I suppose that to me, it was a tough thing to come through because I'm not the same person and I will never be the same person again. But it has its positives because I'm now more aware of myself. I'm quite a positive person. I'm back into work, doing everything full throttle again, because I couldn't have sat in the house. It would have drove me nuts. So what I would say to people is, and Maria and me are testament to it, you know, that we're living every day. It's not to say that we don't get dark days, because there is days where you feel sorry for yourself maybe a wee bit, or something happens and you're reminded of something. So it never really leaves you. I'm sure Maria would probably agree with me. It's always there in some way, but it's how you deal with it, I suppose. And just to say to people that there are people out there to help, like Pretty in Pink, the breast nurses in general, I couldn't have done without, just in fairness to be able to have a conversation with. So, I mean, don't think of it all as a negative. Yes, it'll be quite a daunting time, and there's days where you don't want to lift the duvet from above your head. But I would just say to you is that the services that you have, Leanne, you know, they're invaluable. And I know because of COVID, people maybe are less likely to phone or whatever. But I suppose if they take one thing from this today, that you are on the other end of the phone, and that hopefully when we come out the other end of this COVID stuff, you know, the services are all going to be there for people, and that they should definitely take them up. Because I suppose for me, it was initially difficult for me to ask for help. And I, if anybody's listening to this knows that that's what I do in my role every day. So for me, I'm good at preaching, but I'm not always good at accepting. And it was very difficult to ask for the help, but once I did, the help was there, and there was things that were able to help with my kids and be able to help me in general. So I suppose maybe I've talked too much now. I don't know if you have any questions or there's anything, Leanne, that you think that people maybe need to know or we haven't elaborated on enough. You can maybe come back.
Yeah, Sharon, thank you for sharing that with us. Everybody's story is personal and individual, and it affects people in different ways. And just like you say there, you know, you didn't want to ask for help, but now that you're that little bit further down the lane, you know, what would your message to be anyone who's listening, you know, to say about, what would your message be to them about asking for help or reaching out to those who are there to support them?
I think it's key if people ask for help, because sometimes you don't even know what help exists until you ask for help. You may think that you need one thing, and you may come back with maybe getting three or four different things out of it, because that's where your skilled workers come into play, you know, where they can have a conversation with someone and say, well, what about trying this? Or have you ever thought about, I mean, because see, for instance, like, see, my husband, he probably killed me for saying it, like, but he had never had a therapy in his life. Now he got it through a different service. Was actually the Cancer Fund for Children, because we also got a wee bit of support from them at one point, because of my wee boy in particular was going through a very hard time with my diagnosis. And my partner had never had a holistic therapy, even though I've done acupuncture and all before. He was like, this doesn't work, but it really, really helped him. He was amazed by it. So I mean, I know that you have a whole list of therapies and stuff that you do in here. And it's definitely something that if people don't knock it till you try it, I always say to people as well, you know, at least if you try it and you don't like it, fair enough. But that's what I would say to people. Ask for the help, because it is there. And once you get over that barrier, that it's almost saying it out loud, I need help. That's the difficult part. But once you do that, oh my God, you know, there is so much out there and so many positive things that you can put in play for people in terms of, even if they need like a counseling service or your holistic therapies, which are amazing. or the other stuff, as I says to you, I got a respite break for me and the kids. And also then, because of Pretty in Pink, I was able to get the voucher for my lovely first mastectomy bra. So, which was a surreal experience in itself. But again, it took that financial thing away from you, and you were able to go and you got treated like a human, going and getting measured up and everything else. But it was something that would have been a real daunting experience if that hadn't been the case, that we had got it, that I had got it through yourselves.
Thank you, Sharon, for that. Maria, I'm going to come to you quickly as well, just about, you know, what would your message be to anyone who was in your situation or in and around your age, maybe a little bit afraid of what may happen? What would your message be to anyone in that situation?
Yeah, I'm actually pretty much like Sharon as well. Yes, it is terrifying at the time, but I have had so many positives out of it that I can't even explain. Like, you get so much closer to your own family. You do ask for help, and that's again something that I would never, you know, I'm miss independent, miss self-sufficient. You know, the thought of asking somebody for help was always a bit of a fear for me. And you'll probably even remember that yourself, Leon. At the start, I was all, no, no, I'm dead on. That's, you know, I'm okay, I'll get through this. And that's the way I kind of push myself anyway during life. But definitely asking for help is a major, major thing. You just have to, because otherwise, you know, you eat yourself away thinking about all these thoughts, and, you know, saying it out to somebody else makes all the difference. It is a worrying time, obviously, because of what it is. But as I say, the time you spent with your family, you get time to actually realize, I have been able to step back from the work that I was doing and think, right, is this the way I want to go? Is this good for me? You know, just time to think about your life. And I sometimes take it as, you know, somebody says no to you isn't always a positive, or isn't always a negative thing. And that's something actually that came out from Julianne and the Reiki and stuff. She always said to me, you know, somebody putting a barrier up to you isn't always a negative. It's telling you that maybe you need to look at how you're living or what you're doing and change things. So, I mean, I would never have done anything like this before.
Annie, I'm going to come to you. Obviously, the way the support fund works is, as you know, down in Craigavon, you can make a referral for a patient to the support fund, and you can complete the form for them and help them fill the form in, or they can self-refer in. From your experience, do you feel that people are hesitant to use the service, or do you feel that people are glad that the service is there for them to use?
I think the patients are maybe sometimes a little bit embarrassed of the fact that they have to apply for a grant as such, but at the same time, whenever you explain to them, you know, the origins of the foundation and, you know, the good things that Pretty in Pink can do to help people along their cancer journey, then the majority of patients are delighted to get something. Even if it's only a small amount, it can make all the difference in the world to them. And we have started as Breast Care Nurses in Craigavon. We put in your little flyer into the pack that the girls have talked about, so that they're aware of the charity. And I think sometimes, I mean, I'm in Southern Trust up in Craigavon, Newry area, and they maybe think, oh, Belfast seems an awfully long way away, but it is absolutely not a problem for us as breast care nurses to either complete the form for the patient or just get them to fill in as much as they want, and then we do the rest. I actually think the way it's been done now at the minute for vouchers or for oil, to help towards oil fills, is an excellent way of using your resources, and you know that the patients are going to be very grateful, particularly at this particular moment in time with COVID, because people feel so isolated and vulnerable and alone in their own homes, and they miss the company and all that there. So I think the organisation is absolutely brilliant, and I think that Maria and Sharon are both shining examples of how you can come through a breast cancer diagnosis from feeling so frightened and scared at the beginning to coming through at the end and thinking positively and having the courage to speak even on a Zoom link, because this is all like a whole new ball game.
See, also, Leanne, I think, see, one thing that your service does that probably some other services maybe don't have in the same way is that they also have people who've been through it, who are then providing a service for other people who are going through it, which is a massive positive for your organisation, because it really helps, because sometimes they're the people who understand the most about maybe if you can't make an appointment or you're just not feeling up to it, or you just maybe just want to sit and have a chat rather than having, you know, the therapy initially, or at least having 10, 15 minutes before you actually get the therapy. Maybe just whatever you're going through, and they've been through it themselves. So that's a huge positive to me, you know, like, because they put you at ease straight away, and they also, you know, can sometimes preempt maybe some of the things before you actually say them about just how you're feeling. So that's definitely something that maybe other services don't have in the same way. And it's something that's definitely a big positive for Pretty in Pink.
Yeah, thank you for that, Sharon. I think that the one thing, you know, that really does make us unique, although we are Northern Ireland's only registered breast cancer charity and we cover the whole of Northern Ireland, we do have those people here who have had their experience. For me, it was my sister, and then after Nolene passed away, it was my mommy's diagnosis. So I can relate to people and our therapists and our counsellors and everybody who's involved here. As you say, the hub is a place for people to come in and feel welcome, and maybe not so much to come in just for to use a service, but just to come in for that general chit-chat and speak sometimes about other things. You know, Maria will have been involved in one of our other social outings where, you know, we just get a group of people together who have a breast cancer diagnosis, and you just don't know what flourishes from that. And I think that's really important, which Maria touched on, that there is, we can, like, for example, I put Maria in touch with people, and now I put people in touch with Maria. So it is a really good positive way to look at it. And as you say, people who know what you're going through, there's sometimes questions that people are afraid to ask, because they think, well, it's a silly question, or, you know, don't want to ask that. Nothing's ever a silly question. And those involved within our charity are always there to, everybody has their own different experience and personal experience, so there's always somebody that's going to be able to, you know, answer that question for you. So I'll go back to Anna here about the importance and the awareness of the breast cancer, and especially in young women, and we're trying to get that awareness about the men as well.
Well, basically, I'm going to repeat what I said before. It is vitally important for all women of all ages to regularly, possibly monthly, check both breasts. They would use their right hand fingers to check their left breast, and their left to check their right. And then they get to know their breasts very well. They get into a routine. It's nearly like a monthly task that you do routinely without even thinking about it. And getting into the way of it is so important. So it's just very, you know, it doesn't matter what age you are, because women don't get screening mammograms until after the age of 50. But I have noticed that there are actually younger women these days being diagnosed with breast cancer. And I don't know why that is, but it's just so important for all women to be vigilant and to get to know their own breasts, because nobody knows their own body like yourself. And I think, as one of the ladies had said earlier on, you know, if you spot a problem, you act promptly, you go to your GP. Sometimes you may nearly have to insist on an appointment or a referral, but if that's the way, then so be it. Although GPs are generally very, very good at referring ladies to breast clinic. I think it's been a difficult year, back to this COVID crisis again, and it may well have nearly frightened some women who maybe noticed a change, a lump or a bump or a thickening in their breast, and they were nearly afraid to report to their GP, just in case they were going to be sent to the hospital, and they were nearly afraid to go to the hospital in case they contacted COVID. So I think now things are well improved. The vaccine is well underway, and hospitals are generally safer places to go to than they used to be. Does that make sense?
Yes, Ali, thank you so much, and thank you for reassuring people, you know, to do that. It is vitally important that if you do detect a difference in your breast, or you do have a lump that you have, you do go and get it checked out. As we keep saying, early detection does save lives. Thank you to everybody for getting involved today. All of that information is really important, and it's important for us as a charity to get that out there as much as possible. The two stories from both Maria and Sharon are both real positive stories, although the diagnosis itself may not be a positive. They have taken quite a lot from that, and they have used the Pretty in Pink charity. So I suppose I want to reassure people that throughout the COVID pandemic, we may have been closed, but we still are providing support to patients with breast cancer. Our support fund is continually ongoing, and I would encourage anyone who, if you need the support or you know someone who needs the support, to please contact our office. As I say, that support is really important at this minute in time. We have moved some of our services from face to face, so we're now offering telephone counselling. Again, that is something that you feel that you may benefit from. I do understand it's not for everyone, and face to face contact is so important for some people, but if you feel that may be of benefit to you, then again, please give us a call. And then once we're up and running, you know, things hopefully get back to normal further down the line, don't be afraid to contact us if it is for a therapy, or you've been through this on your own the last year and you are struggling a wee bit. We want to reach out to everybody and try to reach out to as many people as possible to ensure that they get that support there that is needed. So all information can be found on our website, prettyinpink.org, and our telephone number is 0289034 7780. As I say, if you or anybody that you know of, family or friend, you think they maybe just need a self-referral, then that's okay. Please do get in contact with us. There's lots of things that aren't happening at the minute, and I totally understand people are afraid and they sometimes don't want to come along or don't want to ask for help because there's so many other people in the same situation. But for us, it's what we do. It's what we're here for. We are providing fills of oil, helping with gas and electric. We're providing some food parcels for those who need the food. We are still ensuring that people have the essentials they need if they have to go into hospital, you know, pajamas and underwear and hygiene products, things like that. We are still doing our voucher scheme for the mastectomy underwear, albeit that they aren't open, but that's something that you can get booked in for and use down the line whenever they are opened. We use Orchid Laundry for that service, and if anyone is kind of really struggling, maybe you've had your surgery, you don't have your mastectomy underwear yet, they are there to help you. They'll do a Zoom call. It won't be possible probably to get fitted properly, but they will give you some advice and information on that. So again, that's a really important thing that I know a lot of people have been struggling with. So anything like that, please do get in contact with the charity, and say we are here to continue to provide that help and support throughout the pandemic until we can reopen again.
Okay, thank you.